What is Wimbledon? For 125 years, players and fans have made the pilgrimage to SW19, a quiet suburb of London, to try to find the answer.
You behave almost in a different way when you come here because you are aware of what it means to the sport and the richness of the tradition of the place.
At its core lies a simple rectangle, 78 feet by 36 feet. Surrounded by 18 other identical rectangles. Add some texture, grass, out of date in tennis terms, but vivid and tactile. Who wants to touch clay or hard court? Simply the most famous lawn in the world.
As far as Wimbledon's concerned, it's all about the players. What we do is to provide the right stage, the right environment for them to perform on.
Now start painting the broad strokes. Tradition, pomp, ceremony, quintessentially British.
Wimbledon is this extraordinary mix of British tradition and then the sport at its most modern best.
Fill in the background. Fans, polite but supportive. Jingoistic, maybe. But with no British men's singles winner since 1936, give them a break. Finally, the masterstrokes, the players, artists and artisans, punchers and counterpunchers, all of them seduced sooner or later by its unique aura.
It's a feeling, and some people have it before they even get there, but those that didn't have it, they certainly get it later, and it touches everyone.
But what is in Wimbledon's aesthetic, its DNA, that makes this place one of the most enduring and endearing sports arenas in the world? In celebrating Wimbledon's 125th anniversary, we discover the reasons. We begin with the years 1877 to 1939. A typical scene for many a young player dreaming of one day becoming Wimbledon champion. But these four young girls are in fact following in fabled footsteps. It was here at Warple Road, now the playing fields of the Wimbledon High School for Girls, that the championships were first played in 1877. The game would be recognisable to the first competitors, but only just. No one could have anticipated how Wimbledon and its championships would come to dominate the landscape of a game first regarded as no more than a gentle pastime for the lawns of the country gentry. 22 players entered the first men-only championships, with Spencer Gore, an old boy of Harrow School, claiming the first prize of 12 guineas and a silver challenge trophy.
Play.
The championships probably came and went with very little fuss. I mean, you have to remember that tennis did not have any working class roots. I think they called it patter. This sort of faux sport was not for them. And you have to give credit to the members who actually stuck their necks out and decided to go ahead with this completely novel championship. It could have remained a marginalised niche sport that fizzled out like croquet.
Over the next few years, popularity of the game and of Wimbledon grew and broadened, fueled by a women's singles title, first won by Maud Watson in 1884. The club came to claim a central position in the world tennis calendar, adopting, if only for a few years, the title of the World Championships on Grass.
It was a day out, and people took it quite seriously. At this early period, it wasn't at the stage of getting onto the London social calendar, like Henley or Ascot or Lords, but there was a presence about it. You're beginning to get the cultural aspect of being seen at these events.
Times have indeed changed through the years, but not so much. A day out at Wimbledon has become a social and sporting necessity, a must-do for all walks of life. Everyone, it seems, wants to be part of the summer garden party, which, with its champagne and strawberries, is so intrinsically linked to a British summer. A tennis tournament, yes, but also a place to be seen and admired. Royal patronage, which continues through to this day, only underlines its standing.
You have a sense that it's a very privileged lifestyle that you're stepping into, and that it's an extraordinarily elegant experience, but at the same time, it's very inclusive. I mean, you can walk around the grounds and you'll see people from all walks of life and from all over the world coming to enjoy the sport. So I don't think it's elitist in that respect, but you do still have a sense of grandeur and that it's a special place to be.
As Wimbledon became more and more popular at the turn of the 20th century, so did its champions. But all were happy to conform to the dress, decorum, and attitudes expected of Victorian England. Then, someone tore up the rule book.
I think every now and again, along comes somebody special in sport who transforms it and widens its appeal. Certainly Suzanne Lunglen was such a person.
Before the modern tennis superstar, before Chrissy, Steffi or Serena, came Suzanne Lunglen. Flamboyant, flighty and feisty. Such was her reputation that spectators trampled over the hedges to watch her debut in 1919 on court 4 at the Old Warple Road.
The fact that Suzanne was really the first great electric woman player meant so much to Wimbledon, to come out and see this extraordinary female athlete.
She was a wonderful personality. Not a very pretty girl, but a very vivacious one, and her personality won over people with this beautiful balletic grace moving so wonderfully on the court. And her accuracy and control of the ball was second to none.
Lunglen may have won 6 singles titles, but it was her French sense of style and a diva's temperament that she was best known for. While outside the courts, the suffragettes were fighting for women's rights, inside Wimbledon, the fortunes of the fairer sex were far more advanced. Lunglen led the way, with dresses a trifle shorter, a little flimsier, and a lot more risque than everyone else's.
Her dresses were copied as women's fashion and sold in the shops. And French women would buy them and thought how wonderful they looked in Suzanne dresses.
She was a character like we've never had, certainly, and I'm not so sure there's ever been a women athlete like her. You know, she would entertain the press after a match in her bathtub. I assume there were soap bubbles, but maybe not. She was a very fluid tennis player. You see the pictures of her jumping and so forth, and it was not uncommon for one breast of the other to fall out of her outfit. And on the French Riviera, they had even named her breast Marion Jane. And the wise guys would say, who do you think we're going to see today, Mary or Jane? It did not bother Suzanne one bit. She'd tuck it back in and go right on playing.
Longlan may have laid the foundations of fashion at Wimbledon, but it was designer Teddy Tinling who raised the hemline to another level. His outfits for Gussie Moran, not Wimbledon's greatest player, still managed to raise eyebrows around the world in the 1940s. His creations continued to inspire on-court fashion trends for the next 30 years. Wimbledon became a fashion parade almost as much as a tennis tournament, as players and clothing companies began to capitalize on the best catwalk in the sporting calendar.
It's a very personality-driven game. It's a very individual sport, and I think that their personalities show through with what they're wearing. And I think that the world of Nike and Adidas and Lacoste and everybody else has realized that, and more with, you know, new fabrics and new designs, they're realizing that this can be just so important for their different brands through the young men and women that are wearing them on court.
We think always about the backdrop, and that's the color of the court or of the walls, the baseline walls behind them, whatever the advertising or lack of advertising might be. At Wimbledon, it's so pure and clean, so it forces you to be more clever with cut lines and with a neckline or something that might look more dramatic just in white, as opposed to relying on a bright color fighting against a court backdrop.
Fashion statements have become stronger and more daring. Sometimes too strong, too daring. But the All England Club's predominantly white clothing rule is just one way that Wimbledon asserts its uniqueness over every other tournament in the world.
It feels like its own environment. You know, the rules are set in stone, and there's no getting around them, and there's no bending them, and it runs a certain way. You feel like you're part of something that's much bigger than not only you, but in many ways, it feels bigger than the sport.
There's a very hefty apparel manufacturing guidebook showing what is and is not acceptable. There are certain specific asks, and one of them is that the back of the garment should be all white. So we definitely pay attention to that and design into those rules. But you never quite know until you get to that point whether or not the apparel will pass.
Instead of restricting choice, the all-white rule has created an aesthetic, a simplicity that only adds to the glamour and sex appeal at the very heart of the game.
I think when you're watching tennis at its highest level, it's like watching ballet. I mean, they're so elegant and athletic at the same time that it's a celebration of men and women's bodies. And I think that's become much more prevalent, say, in the last 5 or 10 years, when there's just so much more exposure for the game. And obviously, since it's a game that's really driven by young, very attractive people, fashion goes hand in hand with that particular group.
Fittingly, Suzanne Longlan hit the very last ball on the old centre court at Warple Road. The crowds that tennis's first celebrity attracted meant Wimbledon had to find a new, bigger home in 1922. The chosen site, just 4 miles up the road, at Church Road, SW19. When Longlan flounced off court in 1926, after an argument about her punctuality, she was unbeaten. She turned professional, a hint of troubles to come, and never returned. But by then, Wimbledon, with its new centre court, modelled on the old, and its broad acres, could live without Longlan. The championships and the game had developed a life of its own, finding new ways to thrill each year.
for me, Wimbledon has always been a very special place ever since I came here as a junior. But I remember walking through the main gate and up the main concourse and thinking, wow, I'm actually going to be playing on these courts at Wimbledon. Whoa, what a thrill.
In the 20s and 30s, overseas players began to dominate the tournament. Strapping Americans like Bill Tilden with his booming serve and blistering ground strokes. The French musketeers, Jean Borotra, Henri Cochet, and René Lacoste. The red-headed Californian, Don Budge, who perfected the attacking backhand stroke and won the first ever Grand Slam of major titles in 1 year.
What do you think about English summer, Mr. Budge?
Well, I think you had that last week.
Ever-growing crowds flocked to see the insatiable American Helen Wills Moody, winner of 8 Wimbledon singles titles, a feat that would not be beaten for over 50 years. But the best remembered among the home crowd, Fred Perry, the last British men's singles winner, who claimed 3 straight championships in the 30s.
I am very pleased to think that I have at last fulfilled the trust placed in me by the Lawn Tennis Association and carried off the title at Wimbledon. In so doing, I have achieved my own life's ambition.
By the start of the Second World War, the pattern was set. Champions no longer made Wimbledon. Wimbledon made champions. The bond has only strengthened over the decades.
You try to transport yourself in time to the 20s, to the 30s, to the 40s, and imagine all those great players playing there, and you just feel it all. So you feel very much alone, but at the same time, surrounded by history and surrounded by all those people that had played there, whether they're alive or not.
But for every winner, there has to be a loser. The list of great players to have never won Wimbledon is a very long one. To many, an eternal blot on their careers.
Someone could win 5 French Opens, 10 Australian Opens, 6 US Opens, but if they didn't have one Wimbledon, they wouldn't quite feel as though they were fulfilled.
Games have a match cash.
You win that one, and baby, that's all you need. I can still see cash, the first one, going up, left the court, and went into the stands. He started that whole tradition. If he had done that, if he had won the US Open and done that, I don't think it would have been embedded in my memory like that. And likewise, if you don't do well at Wimbledon, you go to your grave, somebody saying, yes, he was a great player, but he didn't win Wimbledon.
All I wanted to do was win that Wimbledon title. And that's all I ever concentrated on. You know, I didn't care about the money, I didn't care about the girls, well, I cared about the girls. I didn't care about the fame, I didn't want any of that stuff. All I wanted to do was to win Wimbledon.
While champions come and go, Wimbledon has to balance past, present, and future.
I think we're very conscious that the whole image of Wimbledon is based on tradition, going back to 1877, keeping those things that are vital to us, grass court tennis, white clothing, limited amounts of advertising around the grounds. But in the same breath, we're in a competitive sports event business, and we need to innovate as well and to change as the years go by.
From the construction of Church Road on, the club has tried to improve and expand. Sometimes the changes are too discreet to even notice, but there is no hiding the march of time. In 1997, the old number one court was demolished and replaced by a new state-of-the-art 11,000-seater stadium.
The client doesn't so much define the restrictions, it's other things that come into play, and at Wimbledon, it's the site, it's the history of the grounds. When you go into a club like that, you've got to be very careful about what you do so that it doesn't detract from it. If anything, hopefully every time we touch a piece of it, it is just that little bit better each time.
It was the notorious British weather, one of Wimbledon's more enduring, if unwanted, images, which led to the biggest architectural change in recent years. When the All England Club decided to build a retractable canopy on centre court in 2006, many thought it would have been far cheaper to build an entirely new structure than to install a roof on a stadium built in 1922. But remember, this is Wimbledon.
What they did with centre court is quintessentially English. So what they could have done was to build a 50,000 seat purpose-built arena with lots of corporate hospitality facilities and the latest state-of-the-art technology, but they didn't. What they did is they simply took what they already had and they accentuated it.
I think the public response to the roof has been nothing other than positive. Of course, we've had a lovely situation where the sun shone ever since we built it, and long may it stay that way. But the reaction to taking an existing building, remodeling it, bringing it up to date, putting a roof on it, I think has been a better option for us than having to relocate.
Entering the grandest of stages in the game on finals day remains one of life's seminal moments.
Okay, boys, let's go. Good luck to you both.
The walk onto the hallowed turf of centre court. The glance at that famous quote. The sense of anticipation. The players feel it, the fans do. It's palpable.
And there's that lovely moment, and you can't see them, but you know they're coming because some people can see them, and there's that applause that gets louder and louder and louder, and suddenly they actually come into your view. The hairs still stand up on the back of your hands, and the day that doesn't happen, the day you should go off and be a gravedigger.
No other 21st century sports arena has the same intimacy or dignity as Centre Court. No scoreboard telling fans to clap. No public announcer. No rock music. No cheerleaders. No mascots. No need.
It's a great feeling to be able to be there and to see the court that as a kid you grew up watching, and I just love the whole atmosphere of the echo of the ball and just the quietness that they have, you know, before the point, and then it's the most unique place I've ever played.
Ready? Play.
No vista on centre court appears by chance. Everything is designed a certain way.
Even when you're sitting at the back of the stadium, the roof slopes down so much that you can't see the rest of the stadium. All you can see is this very tight green slot where the players are playing on that pristine piece of grass. So the building, it focuses the attention to that one intense moment, one man playing against another, one woman playing against the other. And I think the building helps that experience. It helps that intensity.
It's tradition. It means something around the world. It's the well-cut English lawns. The sense of fair play, not shouting, not swearing, making sure that you're respectful to your opponents. You know, this is all part of the package. It's all part of the deal. And I think in many ways it really kind of harks back to an England of certainly of the 19th century, possibly the 20th century. But it's an England, and I think it's a world where these kind of values and these qualities are no longer present.
Even though the court has changed in its construction and the way it looks over the years, there's still that sense of this is the epicenter of tennis.
A champion's back garden and a challenger's distant land. Never rough or raucous, insistent yet sympathetic, claustrophobic and very public. There is nowhere to run, no place to hide on centre court. Just a place to try and claim as their own for a while. knowing that no matter who they are all just passing through. The years 1877 to 1939 laid the foundations of Wimbledon and tennis in general. The period after the Second World War turned the sport into a business. Professionalism arrived, and it was the All England Club who was first to act.
Why just tennis players can't be paid? It didn't make any sense. And that ultimately was the stroke, the lightning, that changed the whole game, because all of a sudden, and it was Wimbledon, looked and said, you know, this is insane.